A very common iOS developer interview question is to explain the difference between classes and structs. I'm going to teach you the answer to that question by explaining value types and reference types. And I've got a nice little analogy using Google Sheets and Microsoft Excel to help you remember. And then I'll teach you when you should use classes and when you should use structs. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Classes and structs are both ways to create objects in the Swift programming language. As you can see here, I have a class called car, which is creating an object. The car has a year, make, and model. More realistic examples in an app would be something like a user or a product, but for the sake of explaining this concept, we're gonna stick with our simple car. So the main answer to this interview questions on classes versus structs is that classes are reference types and structs are value types. What does that even mean? Well, let's write some code to show you an example. So I have my car class here. Let's create a car. We'll say var my car equals, and I'll initialize the car. You can see I need to pass in a year, make, and model. So say 2022, make, Porsche, color, gray. So I've created a car with year, make, and color. Because this is a class, this is a reference type. What that means is that it's a reference or a pointer to specific data. So for example, if someone steals my car, right? So if I do var stolen car equals my car, right? So I took this my car object and set it equal to stolen car. Well, now I have two variables. Again, it's a reference. They're both pointing to the same piece of data, which is this car here. So on the stolen car, if someone wants to make, you know, my car a different color, it's going to affect the original my car. Let's see this here. So if I do stolen car.color equals yellow, and then if I do print my car.color, you notice I'm not printing stolen car.color, I'm printing my car.color. If I run that, you're gonna see my car.color prints out yellow. And this is where the Google Sheet analogy will help you remember this. So the way a Google Sheet works, right, you share the sheet with multiple people, and then when multiple people make changes to that one source of truth, right, they can all make changes to that Google Sheet. It's a shared document. That's kind of how reference types work. Again, I changed the color property on the variable stolen car, but it also changed the property of color on the variable my car, and that's demonstrated on line 18 by printing out mycar.color. So again, classes are reference types, and if you create multiple variables of the same class, they're all gonna point to the same piece of data, and if you change that piece of data on any one of those variables, again, we have my car and stolen car, it is going to change that property for all of those variables that are all pointing to that same piece of data. That is a reference type. Now let's talk about structs and value types. So I'm gonna copy this class here, and then I'm gonna comment it out just so you don't lose all the code here. And then we'll paste that in here. Instead of a class being a car, we'll do a struct of a car. And then structs have member-wise initializers. That's another topic, so I don't have to have that in it. And I have my struct of a car, same thing. Again, they're both ways to create objects in Swift. But structs are value types. Remember, classes were reference types, structs are value types. When a value type gets passed around, it is copied. And this is where the analogy of the Microsoft Excel spreadsheet comes in, right? If I have my own Excel spreadsheet, I made all my changes to it, I save it, I make a copy of it, and I email that copy to you, well, now when you get that copy, that's yours. You can make all kinds of changes to that spreadsheet. You can do whatever you want to it. It is not going to affect my original file version. So that is the analogy for value types, where again, reference types was like a Google Sheet, where everyone can make changes to the one source of truth. Let me demonstrate that in code. So I'll come up here, copy the my car variable. We're kind of gonna do the same example, but you'll see. Now if I do var stolen car equals my car, well now that it's a struct, that basically just made a copy of my car and assigned it to the variable stolen car. So now if I do stolen car.color equals, we'll say red now. Now when I print my car.color, again, my car was the original object that I created, it is still gonna be gray, I hope, right? That's how it should work. Run it, gray, there it is, right? And if I did print stolen car.color, now it's gonna print out red. Because again, struct is a value type, so it created a copy of my car and assigned it to stolen car, where again, as a class, the reference types all pointed to the same underlying data. Now let's talk about when you should use a class versus a struct and the pros and cons of both. A benefit of classes is that they have what's called inheritance, which means I can subclass, so our car class up here, I can create a subclass of car, maybe called race car, that inherits all the basic properties of a car, right? Our year, make, color, but I can also add more properties to that, right? I can maybe add a number, right? Race cars have numbers, and a team, race cars have teams. So you can see it gets all the basic car stuff, but I can add on the unique stuff that a normal car doesn't have, but a race car would have. That's called subclassing. And when you subclass, you inherit everything in the parent class. Another common example, and I'll show you some documentation that will help out here, is if you say class my custom button, and that inherits from UI button. And if I option click on UI button, we'll go to the documentation. So when I make my custom button, I don't want to reinvent the wheel. Everything Apple has done to make a button work. Like, look at all this stuff in the documentation that you get. Customizing color, edge insets, you know, setting the title. I'm going to go down to the bottom here of all the properties that are on it, right? Set title, title color, all the stuff that Apple has built in a button, you inherit when you create your custom button. And then now you just add differences you want to make to make your button custom. Maybe you want it to be a circle and always be pink, who knows? But that's what you can do with inheritance. You can build on top of the UI button. Now that sounds like a really cool benefit, but as you can imagine, when you're inheriting everything of a UI button, which also inherits from UI view, you're starting to inherit a lot of bloat and extra baggage you may not need. So that is where structs come in value types. If you don't need all that inheritance, you can just use a struct. And that's why structs are a lot more lightweight and performant. And if you've written SwiftUI, you'll notice a lot of SwiftUI is built on structs for that exact reason, right? A SwiftUI view is a struct, so it can be created and redestroyed all the time, and it's not so heavy. So when you need inheritance or you need a reference type, that's when you go for a class. When you don't need inheritance and you want something lightweight and performant, then you go with a struct. If you're watching this video, you're probably studying for an iOS developer interview. A great way to get a lot more of those interviews is to have a great portfolio site to show off your work or a personal webpage or blog. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're all developers with the skills and the desire to build the webpage ourselves. But I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.